Welcome to this lecture on the Refined Process Mining Framework and Operational Support. In this lecture we are going to do two things. First of all, we zoom out a bit. We talk about different types of applications. We talk about how to conduct a process mining project. We will see that depending on whether you have lasagna processes or spaghetti processes, the way in which you apply process mining will be very different. But before going into these more applied topics, we first focus on forward-looking types of process mining. And we do that using the so-called refined process mining framework, which is also described in the book. Okay, so this is the picture that we have seen several times before. It shows the whole pipeline of process mining applications. And before zooming out and talking about how to conduct a process mining project, we focus on the tail of this pipeline, where we are looking into the future, where we are trying to, for example, make predictions, where we look at the relationship between process mining and simulation to explore what-if scenarios. That is the focus of what we talk about in this lecture. Recall that in the previous lectures, we first focused very long and very detailed about control flow. In the last two lectures, we added other perspectives such as time, data, and resources. Okay, so this is what we will talk about. Refined process mining framework, operational support, meaning predictive analytics and other forward-looking techniques. Then the L-STAR lifecycle model, that is basically describing to you what are the phases of doing a process mining project. And at the end, I characterize two types of processes, lasagna processes and spaghetti processes. Why they are called like that, you will see immediately if you look at the corresponding process models. So we have been focusing on, let's say, a relatively simple set of process mining techniques that were, let's say, very clear. That was, for example, process discovery. Given an event log, we try to discover a process model, for example, a PetriNet or a BPMN model. Then we looked at conformance checking. We take as input an event log and a process model, and we try to detect where in the process model does the real process deviate, how severe that is, when that happens. And in the last lecture, we added these additional perspectives. So, for example, decision point mining was looking at the data. Organizational mining was looking at the people executing activity instances or the departments that were involved in that. And in bottleneck mining, we were looking at, okay, where are the biggest delays in the process and what may have caused them. There are, in the field of process mining, there are, let's say, many, many other topics that one can look at. So, for example, something that we did not talk about at all is a topic like concept drift analysis. So we may have a process that is stable for some time, and then the process gradually starts to change. So we see sequences of activities that we have never seen before. So concept drift analysis aims to detect such changes in the process, and the moment that they happen, you also would like to have diagnostics of what is going on. A topic that we will cover later is something like distributed process mining. What to do if your data set is so large that you cannot analyze it using just one computer. You need to use a network of computers, meaning that you need to split the data in different parts and analyze them separately. That is a topic that we will discuss in the next lecture, but many of the things that you see here are, let's say, beyond the scope of this introductory course into process mining. Another difference is that there is the offline situation and the online situation. So offline means that you just look at historic data. Online means that that you look at processes while they are evolving, and that has two consequences. It may have a technical consequence that you need to deal with streaming data. it also has like a content related aspect, because if you look at the online scenario, you can still influence the cases that are being processed. So that triggers things like operational support that we will look at in this lecture. So this is a picture that you've seen many times before, and we basically refine this picture into this picture. And this in the book is called the Refined Process Mining Framework, because it basically details the simple, let's say, reference model that we have seen before. And I'm simply going to walk through this bigger model. Note that I'm now looking, so here in this diagram, I'm going from top to bottom. So I first look at the top part. So we have a real world that is being supported by information systems. And these information systems, they record things that have happened. Sometimes this can be very complicated. For example, if you have an SAP HANA-based system, it could be that you have 800,000 different tables with information. So this may be very complicated. The term provenance that you see on this slide emphasizes the fact that in many situations, you want the recorded data to represent the way that it has really, that things have really been developing. So provenance refers to the data being faithful, the data being safe, and that you are able to basically replay history. So you have trails that correspond to real behavior as they have happened. What you also see in this diagram is that we are distinguishing between pre-mortem data and post-mortem data, also called historic data and current data. If we look at historic data, we are basically looking at the execution of cases that have completed. So if we are analyzing an event log, we often make the assumption that of the cases that we've seen, we have seen the whole case. It's not that something is going to happen in the future. If you have that mindset, and that you assume that of the cases that you're analyzing, you've seen everything, we talk about post-mortem data. Current data or pre-mortem data refers to data of cases that have not yet finished. So if I would make an example, suppose that we would look at hospital data and we look at the analysis of COVID patients, then historic data would describe patients that have been treated, and some of them may have died, others have survived, but we are looking at complete cases. If in that same scenario we are looking at pre-mortem event data, we are interested in the cases that have not completely been finished. So people did not die yet, but people did not also leave the hospital in a healthy state. With pre-mortem data, we are looking at patients that are still being treated and where process mining can be used to improve their treatment, just as an example. So we look at running cases, cases that are still alive. It's a bit of a strange term in this context. So process mining results can be exploited to improve the handling of such still running cases. That's the basic idea. If you look at the bottom of the model, then there is the difference between de jure models and de facto models, and we have the different perspectives. And the perspectives are things that we have covered in the last two lectures. For example, with decision mining, we were focusing very much on data and rules. We focused on organizational mining, mining social networks, that the focus is on resource information. We also, of course, looked at timing information. There could be other perspectives, for example, financial aspects of the things that we are executing. That's one difference. Then we have the difference between the de jure models and de facto models. So a de facto model aims to describe reality as it really is. And so de facto models are sometimes also called descriptive. We try to describe reality. We're not trying to change reality. We try to describe reality as is. If we look at de jure models, they are not descriptive, they are aimed as being normative. So the basic idea is that we have a model and we want reality to behave as the process that we have modeled. So if we are doing conformance checking, we often look at de jure models, because we would like to see where does the real process deviate from the process that we would like to execute. Now you understand, let's say, the top and the bottom part of the refined process mining framework. And now we can look at the middle part, which lists 10 different activities. And these activities are grouped into three categories: cartography, auditing, and navigation. Of course, this is not intended to be complete, but what is nice about this diagram is on the model side, we are distinguishing very clearly between descriptive and normative models. We are distinguishing between the different perspectives. At the top part, we are distinguishing between historic data of cases that have completed and data of cases that we can still influence. And by looking at these combinations, we easily end up, let's say, with 10 activities that I'm going to describe. So here we are now looking at the first group. So we have discover, and this is related to process discovery, what we have seen before. Then we have enhance. This corresponds to the situation that you already have a model. You also have historic data, and you're trying to improve or extend the model based on the data that you have. So here you are looking at, for example, adding, we have a control flow model and we add the organizational dimension, or we add information about the decisions being taken, or we have a process model that does not completely accurately capture what is really going on, and we repair the model to better fit reality, but at the same time stay as close to the original model made by people. Then there is diagnose. That's a bit unrelated to the things that we have talked about before, but for example, if one would look at classical simulation, where people are modeling without using any data, but they are just modeling to get a feel of what is this process about, that can be seen as a form of diagnosis. And so we only use the models, we don't use the data. Then we have the group auditing, which is composed of four activities: detect, check, compare, and promote. And what is important in this diagram, let me switch on my pointer, what's important in this diagram is that what goes into all of these steps, and that is in a way already explaining what is going on. So if you look at detect, we are just using the de jure model, the model as we want reality to be, and we are comparing it continuously with current data, so cases that are still running. And the moment that we detect a deviation, let's say a move on model, a move on log, then we immediately generate an alert. And that is detect. You could also see that as conformance checking on the fly. Then there is check. This is the classical offline conformance checking. So we just look at historic data and a de jure model, so a normative model, and we do conformance checking as we have seen it in the earlier lectures. Then there is compare. So here we are not using data, but we are comparing the de jure model and the de facto model. Of course, we are here indirectly using data, because the de facto model was based on the data that we had. Finally, there is promote. So this means that we are moving elements of the de facto model to the de jure model. Yeah, so we promote parts of the model as the process is really being executed to the de jure model. And so here we are balancing between what is really happening and what we looked at, what we want to happen, and we try to refine the model. This is very important. It could be that you start off with a very naive assumption about how the process is being executed. Then you apply process discovery and you see that people do things sometimes completely different, but some of these things may be good and you would actually like to support them, and then you add them to the Euro model. Now we are at the last block, the navigation block, with three activities: explore, predict and recommend. So explore is again a bit less related to the things that we have seen before. So there we are exploring data. So there's a combination of using event data and models to explore things at runtime. Then more closer to the things that we will talk about more in a technical sense is predict. There we are using both a model and current data, and we use that to make predictions. And this is something that we will zoom in a lot of detail in a few minutes. Then we have a recommend. And so if we can predict what is going to happen, we often can also generate recommendations, because we know through our prediction methods, we have an idea of what the effect of certain activities and certain decisions is going to be. And we can use that to recommend, let's say, the best actions to be taken. For example, to minimize flow time, to minimize cost, etc., etc. We are now going to focus on this part that are using data of cases that are that are still running. So remember, if we look at the four generic data science questions that we talked about in the beginning: what has happened is backward looking, why did it happen? For example, we see a bottleneck and we try to explain that bottleneck. That's also backward looking. We are now interested, when we talk about operational support, things about the future. So we are interested in question 3, what will happen, and question 4, what is the best that can happen? In other words, what can we recommend? What do we want to change? If we are talking about operational support, we are basically talking about these three activities: predict, recommend and detect. Why? Because they are using current data. Yeah, so that is forward looking. So detect generates an alert the moment that something is deviating. And you don't say something has happened like last year. No, you generate the alert the moment that the deviation occurs. Then we have predict. This means that we have running cases and we would like to predict certain things about them. For example, what is the likelihood that they will deviate? What is the most likely outcome? Things like that. And what we will see in a few minutes is that if you can predict, you can also automatically generate recommendations. For example, a recommendation could be which person should execute it, or if we can execute multiple activities, or we can execute them in different orders, we can recommend in what order to execute them. We are now going to very schematically sketch this, but I think it's pretty clear. And so we are now interested in running cases. So here we are looking at a scenario where we have a case, and for that case A and B have been executed. C and D will happen in the future, but we do not know that yet. And nobody knows, it is uncertain. But let's just assume that we know what is going to happen to that case. So if you look at the detect scenario, one of the 10, process mining activities, that means that the moment that the deviation occurs, you want to generate an alert, saying that things are too late, not allowed, executed by the wrong person. These are possible statements. Then there is the prediction capability. So we have a running case, we have already executed A and B. We are now at a particular point in time, and we would like, for example, to predict What is the outcome? What will be the completion date of that case? Again, forward looking. Then there is recommend, and that means that we have executed A and B, and we know that certain activities are possible, and we would like to recommend the activity that is, for example, minimizing costs or minimizing the flow time. Just to make it slightly more concrete, but like many things in the, let's say, second half of this course, it is very difficult to present them as pen and paper exercises, like, for example, so if we talk about the alpha algorithm, it's very easy to say, okay, we have this log, now apply the alpha algorithm, show the result. With these more complicated scenarios, that's a bit more difficult, right? Because we need to deal with multiple perspectives, time, resources, etc., etc. So here, for simplicity, I again use a very, let's say, far simplified log. This is the corresponding model of every activity. Here we know the start time and the completion time. Based on such a process model, we can create a reachability graph. And the reachability graph is basically a transition system describing the behavior of this battery net. So for example, and what's also important to see here, because later in our data we will distinguish between the start of an activity instance and the completion of an activity instance. For every activity we have, let's say, an A start and an A complete, for example, for activity A. What we also see is that there is concurrency. So of course, after completing A, we can do B, C, or D. We always do D, and we need to make a choice between C and D, and that leads to the structure that you see here. If this is not clear, just stop the video and try to construct this transition system based on the battery net using the approach that I sketched earlier. Given that setting, so we have event data, we have a model, we would like to detect violations. We would like to detect deviations from the normative model. So that is illustrated here. There is a person working on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, people have designed a normative model. And there is an operational support system that is monitoring, let's say, the continuous flow of partial traces, so traces that have not completed yet, and is comparing them with the operational support system is comparing these partial traces with the model, and the moment that something does not fit, a violation is detected, and that generates an alert. Very schematically, suppose that for a particular case we had an A start and an A complete, then B started at time 25, D started at time 27. This is all still consistent with this model, but now E starts at time 28. But note that B and D have both been started, but in order to execute E, both B and D should have completed, which is not the case. So immediately at time 28, the moment that this event has happened, we know that there is a problem and we can generate an alert with the corresponding diagnostics. So that was detect. Now we look at predict. So now we have a predictive model. Again, we have the operational support system. There are these partial traces. So each time an employee executes an event, a new partial trace is being generated. So for each case, we start with an empty trace and then simply append all the events that have happened. We send these partial traces to the operational support system, and we can make certain predictions based on these partial traces. So for example, we can predict that something is going to be completed at a particular point in time. So examples of predictions are not just the remaining flow time or when something is finished, but this can apply to any feature. So for example, the probability of meeting the legal deadline or some server level agreement is 72%. The probability that a certain person will work on this case has a probability of 0.57, etc., etc. And so here I'm showing various predictions. What you should realize, and I hope I made that clear in the previous lectures, is that from process mining you can basically generate any classical machine learning slash data mining problem where you're trying to explain one variable in terms of the other variables. And that leads to the ability to answer such questions. Again, here I make it very simple. So I have the three cases that we have seen before. We have the transition system, and I'm looking here at the so-called annotated transition system. And the annotated transition system is collecting information about the different events with a strong focus on time. And while we are replaying a case, at any point in time, we record the time of entering a state, the elapsed time since the start of the case, the remaining time from the moment that we enter the state until the case is complete, and the sojourn time, how long we will stay in this state. And let me zoom in a bit so that we can see that. So if we look at the first case, here I'm just considering two cases. Case one is blue, case two is green. If you look at the blue case, case one, it starts at time 12 and ends at time 54. So if we look at like this pointer to the first node, that's where A starts. That is at point at time 10, eh? Because if the first event in the log is happening at time 12, we can just assume, okay, that is the point in time where the case has started. We also know the last event is taking place at 54. So what we say, t is equal to 12 when we are entering this state. The elapsed time is 0 because it's the first event. The remaining time is 42, namely 54, which is the timestamp of the last event, minus 12, which is the timestamp of the first event. And the sojourn time is 7 because a start happens at 12, a complete is happening at time 90, so we take the difference and that's equal to 7. So that was this state. Then we have the A complete for the blue case. So A complete takes place at time 19. So we enter this state at time 19. The remaining time is then 54 minus 90 is 35. The sojourn time is 6 because B start is happening at time 25. So we take the difference between 25 and 19, and that explains the number 6. Then we go all the way to the end, and at the end, like the last event happens at time 54, the elapsed time is then 54 minus 12, and the remaining time is of course 0. There is no sojourn time, because in principle one now stays in this state indefinitely. So that's why I left that out. So I just showed in detail how every case can be replayed on this transition system. And each time we enter a state, we record when we are entering this state, how long it takes until the last event, what is the difference with the first event, and how long are we going to stay in this state. We can collect that by simply replaying the event log on top of that model. And then for any of these attributes, we can compute, let's say, certain statistics. So if we are, for example, interested in the remaining flow time, and again, if I go back to my example, the remaining flow time is the R value here. So for example, if we look at the blue case here in this state, then R is equal to 21. So at any point in time, we know what the remaining time is, and then we can compute statistics over that. And then we know if we are in this state, then on average, the remaining flow time is 42 time units. Of course, I had a super small data set here, so this is not very representative. But again, if you have a process where you have thousands of cases, these statistics will be relatively reliable. So if we are in this state in the process, then on average it takes, for example, 2 days to complete the whole process. In predictions, but this is very application specific, sometimes we need to use contextual information. Just think, for example, of bottleneck analysis. If we look at every case in isolation, it will be very difficult to understand a bottleneck, because a bottleneck is typically caused by many cases competing for the same resource at the same point in time. So this is again the topic of feature extraction. Depending on the topic, we need to somehow make sure that this contextual data is in our event log. So after looking at predictions, we are looking at the topic of generating recommendations. So the idea is now that we have a model, we have partial traces, and based on the model and the partial traces, we are going to recommend to users what is the best thing to do to optimize a certain objective. And of course, there is uncertainty. So we are basically looking at stochastic processes. So it's not always sure what one can do. That is why one can also associate probabilities to certain choices. So for example, here we say that X is recommended with 85% certainty. So recommendations can, just like predictions, be about anything. So it could be, when is the next activity? What is the most suitable resource to execute this? If things are unordered, so in principle we need to do two activities and the order is unspecified, we can, for example, get a recommendation in what order to execute them. In principle, this is generic. Just like feature extraction, this could apply to anything. If we are doing a recommendation, it's very important to understand, unlike with predictions, we are accepting the process as is. Here we are trying to improve the process, so we should have a goal. The goal could be, for example, to minimize time, to minimize cost, to maximize service level agreements, to maximize, let's say, the outcomes that we generate, or to minimize research resource usage. So all of these things are possible objectives. We have prediction techniques to predict whether this is going to happen. And this is a very important slide, because it basically illustrates that if you are able to generate predictions, you're also able to generate recommendations. How does it work? If we are in a particular state that is indicated here with this black dot, and in this state, according to the process model, we can take a number of actions. They are labeled here A1 until AK. So we have K possible things that we can do. And here you can think about selecting an activity, but it could also be related to selecting a resource or the order in which you execute things. If we know what are the actions that we can take at this point in time, we can act as if the thing that we, which is a possible recommendation, we can do as if that has been executed at that point in time, and then we can generate a prediction. So that means that if in this state we have k options, k different things that we can do, and again think of selecting an activity, selecting a resource, then we can artificially do as if we do all of these k options separately. We generate a prediction, And we can compare these predictions, and based on these results, we may recommend, for example, to do A2 rather than any of the other actions. So if we are able to predict, we are also able to recommend. It's very easy to see that relationship. In the next lecture, we will also focus on, because we are now looking at the online scenario, while cases are running, we want to influence them. And this is, of course, also related to topics like streaming event data, where events are coming in at such a high speed that it's impossible to store and to process things later. And so the moment that events have happened, you need immediately act. And this is, for example, also related to things like complex event processing. Because we are talking about forward-looking types of analysis, it's good to also briefly link this to simulation. And this is not a course on simulation, that's a topic in itself. But because it's forward-looking, I briefly summarize this. So with simulation, you can answer what-if questions by building models and exploring the behavior of these models after, for example, making some changes. So again, we need to combine all the different perspectives, just as in the previous lecture. And if we have such an integrated model that contains information about control flow, contains information about resources, contains information about timing and decisions, then we can create a so-called discrete event simulation model. And there are thousands of simulation tools available that can be applied to that. What we see recently is that more and more process mining tools also start to incorporate simulation capabilities. So we are moving from as-is to the to-be situation. And for the to-be situation, we need to explore scenarios that we did not see yet. And so what happens if we make this and this change? So what is simulation? You have a model and you're basically playing out the model. The term playing out has been used in one of the first lectures. And we would like to modify the model and then play out different models and compare them. And here we can, for example, get an indication of what is the effect of adding more resources, what is the effect of making the process more concurrent, etc. So this requires a model, and the model may be partially derived from the data that we can analyze using process mining techniques. And so this is the connection between simulation and process mining. So if we look at the simulation model, and perhaps that is obvious, in a simulation model, of course, we also need to describe the control flow. We need to describe in which order activities are going to happen. We need to indicate probabilities or explicit rules. But if we add explicit rules, we also need to detail the model a lot. And so what you often see in simulation model, you don't show detailed rules, but you basically talk about probabilities. What is very important for things like queuing, waiting times, and stuff like that, is how many resources we have. So we need to model resource behavior. And all of these things can be learned from process mining and historic data. There are also things that kind of correspond to setting up the simulation experiment. So for example, what do we measure, but also to understand how reliable the results of a simulation are, you often use multiple subruns that you compare with each other. So if I run 10 times the same simulation experiments, and all 10 times I more or less get the same outcome, I consider that to be very reliable. If I run the simulation 10 times with different random seeds, and each time the outcome is completely different, it is not very reliable. So this top row is very much related to how to set up the experiment after you have learned the process model, I should better say the simulation model using process mining. In a simulation project, just like a process mining project, there are many risks. They are highlighted here. I'm not going to elaborate on this, but of course, what comes out of the model is what you put in at the beginning. And so if you choose the wrong scope, if you have like hidden assumptions that are not realistic, of course, this will affect the answer. What you often see is that also people are unable, let's say, to ask the right questions. And because of that, it is unclear what the results of the simulation are with respect to the ideas that people had had before. And so results should be interpreted properly. And I earlier gave already a pointer to this famous book, How to Lie with Statistics, which is basically showing that you can tweak simulation models to basically generate any result. My general recommendation when you do simulation, do not focus on the absolute results, but try to focus on a bit hypothetically, if we change something, what would be the effect? Is that positive or negative? And their simulation can be very valuable. Traditional simulation is only using data to estimate parameters, for example, what is the average service time? You can do statistical analysis, and you don't need process mining for that to see the distribution of inter-arrival times, the distribution of service times. Using process mining, you can go towards more advanced forms of simulation. So in these more advanced forms of simulation, there is a more direct connection to real event data, often also of still running cases. What you can basically do, and that's very advanced, is you can build a simulation model based on historic data. Then from the information system, you take data about running cases and you load them into the simulation model. So the simulation model does not start from some abstract artificial state. No, the simulation model starts from the state where the process is in at that point in time. And what simulation then can do is basically provide you with the fast forward. So the simulation model starts in the state where the real process is in today. And we can do a fast forward multiple times using different assumptions to see what is going to happen. For example, if we do not change anything, what is going to happen if we assign two more resources to that activity, etc., etc. What is key here is that, and that is indicated here with this eye symbol, is that what is very nice is that we can observe real event data and simulated event data using process mining software. So we can basically observe both of them in exactly the same way. And this is very important because we can like seamlessly look at real data of how real processes are being executed, and we can explore different alternative future scenarios using exactly the same view. And this is indicating why simulation is going through a revival after for a long time seeing as something completely abstract to something that is much more real through the combination with process mining. So that concludes what I would like to say about forward-looking forms of process mining. So on the one hand, we looked at operational support. We also looked at the relationship with simulation. So in the remainder of the lecture, I'm going to focus on the L-STAR lifecycle model, how to conduct a process mining project, and we will link this to lasagna and spaghetti processes, basically indicating if your processes have these and these characteristics, these and these types of process mining may be more or less useful. So, of course, the big problem is any organization is drowning in data. It doesn't know really how to use such data. And this is often the starting point of a process mining project. And so an organization has problems, for example, customers are leaving, or there is are incredible amounts of rework, there may be any, there may be severe compliance problems. The organization knows that there are these problems, but now it would like to use the data to get more insights and to improve the process. And this is not so easy. So the L-STAR lifecycle model is trying to address this problem. So let's first start with the definition of a use case. So a process mining use case is combining a goal with a specific action. And so we are interested, for example, in improving a certain KPI related to time, so for example, minimizing flow time. And in order to achieve that goal, we are going, using process mining techniques, to take or recommend certain actions. So when we talk about times, it's very diverse. We can talk about mean flow times, mean waiting times, response times, etc., etc. But we can also look at things like service levels. So in service level agreements, it's not so important what the average is. But for example, we are very much interested in the percentage handled within an agreed upon period. So for example, in an SLA, one may have agreed that 95% of all the cases is handled within 2 weeks. And then the average, of course, should be below 2 weeks. But you want to make sure that you try to address these cases that would normally take more than 2 weeks, and that you try to bring under that barrier. Process mining, of course, should be actionable, and that's why it's not just about diagnostics, it's also about taking the actions. And here we distinguish between redesign, adjust, intervene, and support. So let's walk through all four of them. So redesign means that you conducted process mining. You saw that there were certain foundational problems and you change your process. And so for example, if you find out that there is a particular bottleneck, you may want to make the process more concurrent, or you may want to optionally skip things if things take too long. Then there is adjust. That means that you don't change the structure of the process model, but there is a parameter, for example, how many resources you need depending on the workload, and you could adjust that parameter. And that the process itself does not change in terms of structure, in terms of routing, but you adjust the parameter of the model. So this is still at the model level. Then we look at interventions, and interventions are related to specific cases or specific resources. So for example, we see that a certain case is incredibly delayed. That case is very important. So we intervene and try to expedite that case. Or we see that if a particular person is working on cases of a given type, that there are often deviations. And we intervene by contacting that that user and trying to understand why that person is handling his work in a deviating manner. And then we have support, and that has been the topic that we have elaborated on before. There we are, the moment there is a deviation, we want to detect it and immediately generate a trigger. We want to predict things like the remaining times, and we would like to generate recommendations. And so if we talk about operational support generating a recommendation, the action is already clear. If we talk about predictions, where we predict a particular problem, it is still left open how to handle this. So this action part relates to, for example, the action engine of Celonis. Celonis also last year bought, let's say, a low-code workflow company, where you visually can drag and drop workflows, and you can connect diagnostics in the process mining engine to triggering workflows or triggering particular actions if there is a problem. So for example, if using process mining diagnostics, you can see that the average waiting time is going beyond a certain threshold, then you can automatically generate a workflow trying to address that. So if we combine goals and actions, we get use cases. And here there are some examples. I'm not going to talk about all of them. But for example, here, the first use case is identification of bottlenecks to trigger a process redesign that reduces the overall flow time with 30%. So here we are interested in improving KPIs related to time. That's our goal. And the action is a redesign of the process. And so if we talk about predicting the remaining flow time to improve customer service, here we are looking at the goal is again time related, and we are looking at these prediction actions. So this is indicating how we can combine actions with the goals that we have in mind. And already in the earlier lecture, we gave some examples of real life processes. And for example, if you look at the order to cash process in an organization like Siemens, you can see that the number of variants is astonishing. And you have 900,000 different ways of executing the order to cash process. A process for which many people think, okay, this is completely standard, that's always the same. The fact that there are 900,000 variants shows that there are many, let's say, possibilities to improve the process. Next, we are going to look at the life cycle model. So this is the L-STAR life cycle model. It identifies five stages numbered from 0 until 4, and it describes the life cycle that one would like to execute from beginning to end for what we later will call a lasagna process. So if the data is of good quality, you have enough data, the process is in control, not too much variability, you can execute all of these four stages. If you have like spaghetti processes, where the process is not in control, it's changing all the time, and you don't have that many cases, you probably get stuck in the middle. But we will come back to that later. So if we look at the stages, I think it's all pretty obvious. So in stage one, you're planning the project. Of course, you all in many, let's say, organizations, you need to have a business case, although I'm sometimes a bit skeptical about that, because I think if you know that your process has certain problems and you would like to analyze them, you should not need a business case. You just want to have good processes, so you need to want to do that anyway. That's why I was also a strong advocate of making process mining part of the way of life in an organization, something that you apply anywhere at any place. So you need to plan, but in any case, you need to plan the project. Projects can be data-driven, so we have the data, we have no idea what our problems are, but we are driven by curiosity. What can we find? It can be question-driven, and so one has noted in the process that there are certain surprising things and one would like to understand why. Or it can be very much goal-driven, like one could say, for example, the response times are too long. How can we reduce them with 50%? So that's how it starts in stage zero. In stage one, you collect the information, and what you see here is that there are different types of information. So there is event data, there may be models that have been made by hand, there may be objectives, there may be questions, etc., etc. And so it's important that this extraction phase is not just about event data, but about any type of artifact and also about existing domain knowledge. So you would like to make this explicit, and that feeds into the second stage. What is very important to say here, and again, I'm looking at the scenario of using SAP. If you have a system that has hundreds of thousands of different tables, you need to have domain knowledge to see what are the tables that one would like to focus on. So that's part of the input of doing process mining. After you have identified the questions, the objectives, you have extracted the event data, then, let's say, the obvious part starts. You discover a process model and you would like to connect the events in the event log to the process model that you've seen before. So this is where you use a combination of discovery and conformance checking. Discovery to find the control flow model, conformance checking to make sure that the model describes reality and that reality and model are connected to each other. This may be a highly iterative process. It may also be that the models that you end up with are a combination of partly discovery and partly making them by hand. Then there is stage three. So stage three, you basically take the event data and you take the control flow model and you enhance, enrich the model with other perspectives. For example, information about roles. In one of the previous lectures, we looked at automatically discovering roles by viewing all the resources, the workers in the process as a vector and doing, for example, k-means clustering. Then you identify the different roles and you can enrich the model with that. You then merge all of these things in an overall process model. So now we have a process model and we have an event log. This event log is historic. Now in operational support, we are interested in pre-mortem data, cases that we still can influence. So we do not just use the historic data that we got to learn the process model, but we also take into account data about running cases that were not at all used to learn the model. And the combination of this is used for things like detect, predict, and recommend. And we explained that earlier. Now I'm going to relate this L-star lifecycle model to the refined reference model and the use cases that I mentioned before. So this goal setting is part of stage one. Okay, where part of the output are KPIs and questions. The action part is, of course, what do we do with process mining results? Do we redesign the process? Do we intervene when we note that a particular resource is deviating very frequently? This is the action part. We can also connect the L-star model to the refined process mining framework, and I again do that by highlighting. So if we look at stage two, that is related to the activities here that we see in red. So for example, discovering the control flow model, but we also do various things related to conformance checking, etc. Then there is the enhancement. So that is extending the model with other perspectives. That is clearly here. And last but not least, but this is not always possible, we go to stage four, where we have these forward-looking types of process mining based on pre-mortem data. Yeah, so these are the cases that we still can and want to influence. So that basically has provided you with lots of information about the different frameworks. Now, to end this lecture, we will basically take a more applied view without going into much detail, because like there are lots of data sets publicly available and you can play with this yourself. In this part of the lecture, I would like to stress that there is a spectrum of processes going from lasagna to spaghetti. So if we characterize spaghetti processes, they are irregular, unstructured. People that work in these processes consider that the process is very flexible, and there are many cases that are unique. That if you look at the trace of activities, it is different from all the other ones. If we look at the other end of the spectrum, at lasagna processes, we look at processes that are highly structured. They are also repetitive, so many traces, many cases follow exactly the same path. It is controllable, so it has much more structure. And of course, this is a spectrum, so many processes may be somewhere in the middle of these two extremes. Just to sketch it a bit, here I'm looking at a small data set with 528 requests for help in a Dutch municipality. This is the so-called WMO process, where people are applying for household help. Of these 500 something requests, we have 5,500 events. And what you immediately see if you look at this diagram is that it looks very regular, right? All the cases are handled within a relatively short time frame. There are a few exceptions here. And the influx, the inflow, is very regular, because this is almost a straight line. So if you look at the process model, it looks super simple. So this is what the inductive miner generates that can be converted to a PetriNet. We can convert it to a BPMN model. This is very, very simple. So if you have such a process and you would present that to the stakeholders will not be super surprised, because this is kind of behaving in the way that people expect it to behave. But if we now do conformance checking and we are looking at what are now the cases that are fitting, then 505 of the 528 requests, so the number of cases, are fitting. So that means two things. It means that the process model very well describes reality. At the same time, it is interesting to look into these 23 cases that are not following this process model. They may relate to fraud or to things that should have been done differently. We can also, of course, do performance analysis and highlight activities that take a long time. And of course, if you load this into, for example, commercial process mining tools that show the directly follows graph, we see things that look very similar. And so here we see the DISCO tool from Fluxicon, where on one side we see the frequency, on the other side we see the times. And if you look at the frequencies, then you can see very clearly that most of the cases are following the happy path. If we have a simple process like that, we can go until stage four. And in the process that I just sketched, there is no problem applying all the operational support techniques that I've been talking about. But on the other side, just looking at the process model is not enough, right? Because the process model is kind of what people expect to happen. So to summarize, lasagna processes are easy to discover. It's less interesting to show the real process because that is close to what people expect. But the whole process mining toolbox can be applied, and one can also look at these more refined forms of analysis. So using conformance checking, you can look at a few outliers. And what you can also do is you can, for example, do operational support, prediction, recommendation, and all of these types of things. Spaghetti processes are on the other side of the spectrum. Why are they called spaghetti processes? Because if you would analyze the model, they look like this. And so this is an example of a data set from a Dutch hospital in Amsterdam. where we look at a group of homogeneous patients, so patients that in principle had the same medical problem. We have almost 3,000 patients. The event log contains over 110,000 events. And what is, of course, killing to show a process model is there are 619 different activities. So these diagrams in themselves, they make people aware of the complexity, but such diagrams are not directly useful. But they show that there is a lot of potential to explore parts of the process which may be improved. So this is another example of a spaghetti process model, but if you have applied process mining to real life processes, you've seen things like this before. This is the testing of wafer scanners. Here I'm looking into a detailed part. What's perhaps interesting to say is that if we look at cases in this process, then one case often has, let's say, up to 60,000 different events within a single case. So if we have such spaghetti-like processes, do not try to learn a refined process model and apply all the different stages. That is not going to work. The earlier stages will be challenging, but they may also be rewarding because one may see certain things. But one needs to simplify this spaghetti model, because just by looking at spaghetti is not enough. And there are very structured ways of dealing with spaghetti models. The first thing is that you should carefully think about what is the subset of activities that I want to look at. So I showed you earlier a process model of the treatment of patients having all the same disease. But I was creating a process model with over 600 different activities. So it's very obvious to see that when I try to create a process model with 600 different activities, it will never be very clear. So you need to focus on a smaller subset of activities, let's say not more than 20, that are important to understand the process. So here you can, for example, start by looking at the most frequent ones, but sometimes you want to deliberately leave out some of the frequent activities because they are blurring the rest of the picture. Yeah, so just as a mind experiment, suppose that I have a process model with a very clean and nice structure, and I add an activity, just a random activity that happens, let's say, every 5 minutes, for all cases continuously, and I then build a directly follows graph. The directly follows graph will look as follows. I no longer see the structure. I just see, let's say, interactions between this disturbing activity and all the other activities. If we then take out that frequent activity, we suddenly see the structure again. So you need to be smart, use domain knowledge to filter on the set of activities. If you're using a commercial tool, it is very important to not just use a slider to remove activities, but to really create a fresh event log where these activities are being removed. Then your analysis will go much faster and your analysis results are also reliable. If you don't do that, tools may give you very misleading diagnostics. Not if you are using a tool like PROM, but if you're using the DFG miner of several of the commercial systems, the results cannot be trusted. So we focus on a small subset of activities, let's say up to 20 activities. Then you need to ask the question, okay, what is the subset of cases that one would like to look at? So in the hospital setting, you want to look only at patients having the same disease, the same diagnosis. There is no point in trying to make a process model for all the patients that are ever in the hospital. You want to zoom in to certain groups of patients because only then you expect that you will be able to see structure and that you can help to improve the process. So often there are very natural subclasses of cases that you can use. Then you can also apply clustering, as I mentioned before, to not create one process model, but to create, for example, five process models that all look at homogeneous groups of cases. And then it's interesting to understand what these four or five groups correspond to. After selecting on activities, on cases, you can also do, let's say, variant-based filtering, where you look at the paths, and there you're typically either interested in the highly frequent paths, if you are interested in, for example, removing a bottleneck, or you are interested in the very infrequent ones, because that is the case. So I hope that this discussion on simplification is that it doesn't stop by generating a spaghetti-like model and that you think that there is no structure. With these recommendations that I point out here, you can see that you can make any process understandable by focusing on a subset of activities, a homogeneous group of cases, and looking at the most frequent paths. And then you can find structure in most of the processes, and it becomes clear how you can improve them. So just schematically, that you can link it a bit to the tools that I've been talking about. Here, both activity sliders are up. This is data from a Dutch housing agency. So this is describing data from the point in time where people say that they want to stop renting an apartment until it is rented out to other people. If I move both sliders up, I see all the activities and all the paths, and it looks like spaghetti. If I move all the activities down, then you can see it is already very simple because we only have four activities, and we can, here we look at the time view. I could also have shown the frequency view. We can also keep all activities. So note that this slider is up and this slider is down. So in the previous one, this was down and that was up. In this one, it is exactly reversed. So we see all activities, but we only see the most frequent path. Here I'm combining both. So both of the sliders are down. So we see again the same four activities, and we just see the there are basically just two paths, this one and this one. Often, if you go to real-life data sets, some of the process mining tools may become very slow because they try to do sophisticated types of analysis on something that is spaghetti-like. So if you have a process model with, let's say, 1,000 different activities and you try to do process mining, it may be that the process mining tools get stuck in just trying to show the layout of a model with 1,000 different activities. That doesn't make any sense. If the layout algorithm has difficulties producing the layout, as a human you do not want to look at it. So one can use standard tools like Qlik and Tableau, and there are many other, as for example also things like Power BI. There are many, let's say, standard BI-like techniques for data management that you can do to make the data smaller. I think that's often something that you should try to do. Make the data smaller before loading it into a process mining tool. If your process mining tool is choking on the data, then probably the results that you get from that analysis will not be very useful, because you're simply trying the impossible. We spoke about lasagna and spaghetti processes. We could also relate that a bit to the different functional areas within an organization. So an organization typically has a supplier side and a customer side. On the supplier side, there is procurement. On the customer side, there are things like customer relationship management, sales, etc., etc. So in process mining, we often talk about the order to cash process that is on this side, and we talk about the purchase to pay process that is on this side. But of course, in organizations, one can find many more functional areas, production, logistics, internal finance and accounting, product development, services, etc., etc. So in each of these functional areas, there are, let's say, many processes. And although this is not very exact, one could highlight a bit here in blue, where do we expect to find lasagna processes? So for example, procurement is a typical candidate, but also most of the production processes are actually lasagna processes. They are highly structured, and we can do all of the types of process mining that I've talked about before. Then we can look at where do we find spaghetti processes. And there, for example, in product development, there we find processes that may be very unstructured. Also, if we look at customer relationship management, the order to cash process is probably very structured, but there are also parts on interactions with customers that are very unstructured. As I said, please take this with a grain of salt. It is just to make you imagine that if you look at any organization, you will have all of these processes. And what process mining can add very much depends on the characteristics of the processes that we look at. And of course, there are areas where we find both. So to conclude this part, so we can, in lasagna processes, we can detect and remove bottlenecks. If we see a problem, we can analyze the root causes. We can do comparative process mining. So if we have two production units, we can, for example, compare why is this production unit being 10% faster than this other production unit. And you can use all of the forward-looking techniques that I've mentioned. If you have spaghetti processes, many of the things are impossible or do not make any sense. If we have a spaghetti process, there is no point in trying to do operational support. So there, these days people talk about machine learning and neural networks, they don't get the point that it doesn't make any sense to try to do that. If you have spaghetti processes, you need to use the simplification approaches that I mentioned. Then you will see structure and you see often lots of low-hanging fruit on how to improve things. And so it is also, let's say, analyzing these spaghetti processes also lets an organization move from management by PowerPoint to really evidence-based process improvement. So this concludes this lecture. So we have basically covered, let's say, chapters 10, 13, and 14, talking about operational support, the reference model, and the different types of processes. What will be covered in the next lecture is how to deal with process mining if your data is huge. And we will look at scenarios where the data is so large that we need to distribute it over multiple computing nodes, or we look at the scenario where we need to deal with streaming process mining.